In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love the neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Grant unto thy church in all things to follow the precepts of those through whom she received the beginning of religion. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
reading from the book of Acts. In those days, Herod the king laid violent hands upon some who belonged to the church. He killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. This was during the days of unleavened bread. And when he had seized him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four squads of soldiers to guard him, intending after the Passover to bring him out to the people. So Peter was kept in prison, but earnest prayer for him was made to God by the church. The very night when Herod was about to bring him out, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and sentries before the door were guarding the prison. And behold, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. And he struck Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly." And the chains fell off his hands. And the angel said to him, "Dress yourself and put on your sandals." And he did so. And he said to him, "Wrap your mantle around you and follow me." And he went out and followed him. He did not know that what was done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. When they had passed the first and the second guard, they came to the iron gate leading into the city. It opened to them of its own accord. And they went out and passed on through one street, and immediately the angel left him. And Peter came to himself and said, "Now I am sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Beloved, I am already on the point of being sacrificed. The time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all of you who have loved his appearing. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength to proclaim the word fully, that all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil and save me from his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
At that time, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do men say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." The word of the Lord.
Praise be to God.
Let those be ordained priests come forward. Reverend Mr. Gregory Blake Tipton.
Present.
Reverend Mr. Robert Chapman Kirk.
Present.
Most Reverend Father, Holy Mother Church asks you to ordain these our brothers to the responsibility of the priesthood.
Do you know them to be worthy?
After inquiry among the Christian people and upon the recommendation of those responsible, I testify that they have been found worthy.
Then, relying on the help of our Lord God and our Savior Jesus Christ, we choose these men, our brothers, for the order of priesthood.
Thanks be to God.
My dear Ordinandi, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, celebrating ordinations to the priesthood on the solemnity of Saints Peter and Paul, the two princes of the apostles, carries special significance both for the Ordinariate of the Chair of Saint Peter and for the men being ordained. Our diocese is not just named for Saint Peter. We have a unique and intimate connection with his successor. And so the chair of Peter evokes the authority of right teaching and orthodox practice that binds us together in the Catholic family. At the same time, our Ordinariate has, as part of its core identity and experience, an evangelizing mission that is in every sense Pauline. Peter's faith, Paul's zeal for preaching the faith, is, if you will, the spiritual construct of what it means to be an Ordinariate Catholic. And so it is fitting that when it comes to ordaining our priests and sending them into mission, we do so on the feast day of these two apostles. Gregory and Rob, St. Peter and St. Paul are given to you today as your patrons, so that you might imitate their virtues, so that you might immerse yourselves in their apostolic courage, and so that you might come to inherit their heavenly reward. While figures like Peter and Paul certainly evoke a lofty vision of faith and authority and preaching and mission, I would urge you not to overlook the power of their patronage in life's less lofty moments. Ministry is sometimes not fruitful. I think you know this already, but if you don't, you sure soon will. Prayer can be the intimate union of the soul with God. It can also be maddening, frustrating, dry, and unfulfilling. Relationships can sustain you. They can also get on your last nerve and become dry and brittle and cracked. And again, you will experience the fact that your sins do get the better of you. As St. Paul famously said to the Corinthians, we hold a treasure in earthen vessels. The treasure he speaks of is grace, poured out freely in the passion, death, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And those vessels, those are the flawed, fragile, and morally compromised people who nevertheless are called to the more abundant life of grace. Peter and Paul both knew what it meant to deny the Lord, and they both knew the need for conversion that precedes the ministry of proclamation. And they both knew the free and unmerited grace it was to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus. Even in our weakness, as in their weakness, they are our patrons. Last week, we celebrated another patronal feast in the Ordinariate, St. John Fisher and St. Thomas More, whose statues crown the sanctuary behind me. June is rather full of solemn celebrations in the life of the Ordinariate, and I was struck this year again reading the letter of St. Thomas More that he wrote to his daughter Margaret from prison, that he too, a layman, so clearly understood his life and his discipleship under the patronage of St. Peter the Apostle. He wrote to his daughter this: "I will not mistrust the Lord, Meg, though I feel myself weakening and on the verge of being overcome with fear. I shall remember how St. Peter, as a blast of wind, began to sink him because of his lack of faith, and then I shall do as he did. I will call upon the Lord and pray to him for help, and then I trust that he shall place his holy hand on me and in the stormy seas hold me up from drowning." I do not suppose there was really ever a time in the church's history when being a Christian was easy. The church has certainly faced times of severe persecution, as the blood of martyrs gives witness. But our own day has seen an increase of godless secularism, a vaunting of the spirit of the world that belittles faith and scorns the practice of religion, especially in the public square, where the sanctity of human life itself is even called into question, and the holiness of holy matrimony defined out of existence. Those are the blasts of wind. Those are the waves of the storm that do and can cause us to falter. Priests are, after all, on the front lines of this, resisting the spirit of the world by proclaiming the word and by the integrity of their own lives. That is how they give witness to the kingdom of God. You cannot expect to march squarely into the storm and not get knocked down several times. And so we return to that patronage in the words of St. Thomas More. I shall do as Peter did. I will call upon Christ and pray to him for help. And then I will trust that he will place his holy hand upon me and in the stormy seas hold me up from drowning. Thomas More's spiritual connection to St. Peter runs even deeper. He was in prison facing the ultimate test of conscience. And so he goes on in his letter to his daughter Meg. "And if the Lord permits me to play St. Peter further and to fall to the ground to swear and forswear, may God our Lord in his tender mercy keep me from this, and let me lose if it so should happen, and never win thereby. Still, if it should happen, afterward I trust that in his goodness he will look on me with pity as he did upon St. Peter, and make me to stand up again and confess the truth of my conscience afresh, and endure here, now, the shame and harm of my own fault." Priests are given tremendous sacramental authority. Theirs is the ability to work remarkable good for the glory of God and the building of the church. But as we have seen in recent times, theirs is also the ability to work remarkable harm. Let us be clear. Priestly ministry is a test of conscience. It will mean a constant struggle between virtue and sin, between selflessness and selfishness. The spirit of the world is a voice of seduction that will always whisper into the priest's ear. May God our Lord in his tender mercy keep me from this, and let me lose if I should fall, and never win thereby. But you know, this is a struggle that every single saint has faced, and every soul in heaven has won. Rob, Gregory, you have been chosen by God and the church for the office of priesthood, not because of your particular worthiness, nor because of your eloquence, nor because of your unique personal abilities. But your faith in the power of God to accomplish in you infinitely more than you can ask or even imagine, this is your claim on the office that you are about to undertake. His mercy, his power, his grace at work in you. The Petrine authority represented in the keys in the hand of St. Peter is the primacy of love, the credibility of service, and the authenticity of Christian witness. The truth of the gospel, preached in season and out by St. Paul, is represented by the sword, a masculine, powerful symbol, yes, but twice in his letter to the Philippians, and in his second letter to Timothy, he describes himself as being cut to the quick and poured out like a libation. Armed with the sword of God's word, Paul was a man who was ready to first allow himself to be wounded by that sword, to suffer for the gospel, to love and to suffer in love for God's people. And that was his real strength. St. Peter and St. Paul give the church an eloquent example of faith, of zeal and discipleship, and perhaps most importantly, an example of flawed humanity, giving place to the power of grace working in and through them. We can only be stirred to gratitude before the great divine generosity of the Father, who discloses to St. Peter the true identity of his only begotten Son. The great generosity of the Son, who entrusted to Peter and Paul his own mission of proclamation and governance, and the generosity of the Holy Spirit, who in the outpouring of the grace of sacramental orders ensures that this same mission, Christ's own mission of evangelization and governance, is made present in the church of every time and every place. My dear sons who will be ordained to the priesthood today, this is the great work of God that continues in and through your priestly ministry at St. Elred Ordinariate Community in Athens and among the Ordinariate communities in Baltimore of Mount Calvary, Christ the King, and St. Timothy's. See your ministry in the pattern of St. Peter and St. Paul. It's a unique privilege to serve Christ, who is himself the teacher, the priest, and shepherd of the new covenant, to preach the very word of God which first captivated your hearts. It is a grace to perfect the spiritual sacrifices of the faithful by uniting them to the supreme sacrifice of Christ on the cross, which will be offered by your hands in an unbloody way on the altar. And it is a grace of authority that, exercised in fidelity to your bishop, draws the faithful together into one family, so that you might lead them to God the Father, through Christ, in the Holy Spirit. You stand at the threshold now of a great mystery and a test of conscience. Trust in that his goodness, the Lord will look upon you with pity as he did St. Peter, and make you to stand up and confess the truth of your conscience afresh to his glory and for the salvation of souls. Dear sons, before you enter the order of priesthood, you must first declare before the people your intention to undertake this office. Do you resolve with the help of the Holy Spirit to discharge without fail the office of priesthood in the presbyteral rank as a worthy fellow co-worker with the order of bishops in caring for the Lord's flock?
I do.
Do you resolve to exercise the ministry of the word worthily and wisely, preaching the gospel and teaching the Catholic faith?
I do.
Do you resolve to celebrate faithfully and reverently, in accord with the Church's tradition, the mysteries of Christ, especially the sacrifice of the Eucharist and the sacrament of reconciliation, for the glory of God and the sanctification of the Christian people?
I do.
Do resolve to implore with us God's mercy upon the people entrusted to your care by observing the command to pray without ceasing.
I do.
Do resolve to be united more closely every day to Christ the High Priest, who offered himself for us to the Father as a pure sacrifice, and with him to consecrate yourself to God for the salvation of all.
I do, with the help of God.
Do you promise respect and obedience to me and my successors?
I do.
May God, who has begun this good work in you, bring it to fulfillment. Do you promise respect and obedience to me and my successors?
I do.
May God, who has begun this good work in you, bring it to fulfillment. My dear people, let us pray that God, the all-powerful Father, will pour out abundantly the gifts of heaven on these his servants, whom he has called for the office of priest.
Let us kneel.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
our God, and pour out on these thy servants the blessing of the Holy Spirit and the power of priestly grace, that those whom in the sight of thy mercy we offer to be consecrated may be surrounded by thy rich and unfailing gifts, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us stand.
Draw near, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, the author of human dignity. It is you who apportion all graces. Through you everything progresses. Through you all things are made to stand firm. To form a priestly people, you appoint ministers of Christ your Son by the power of the Holy Spirit, arranging them in different orders. Already in the earlier covenant, offices arose, established through mystical rites. When you sent Moses and Aaron over your people to govern and sanctify them, you chose men next in rank and dignity to accompany them and assist them in their task. So too in the desert you implanted the spirit of Moses in the hearts of 70 wise men, and with their help he ruled your people with greater ease. So also upon the sons of Aaron you poured out an abundant share of their father's plenty, that the number of the priests prescribed by the law might be sufficient for the sacrifices of the tabernacle, which were but a shadow of the good things to come. But in these last days, Father most holy, you sent your Son into the world, Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. Through the Holy Spirit, he offered himself to you as a spotless victim, and he made his apostles, consecrated in the truth, sharers in his mission. You provided them also with companions to proclaim and carry out the work of salvation throughout the whole world. And now we beseech you, Lord, in our weakness, grant us these helpers we need to exercise the priesthood that comes from the apostles. Grant, we pray, Almighty Father, to these your servants the dignity of priesthood. Renew deep within them the spirit of holiness. May they henceforth possess this office which comes from you, O God, and is next in rank to the office of bishop. And by their example and manner of life, may they instill right conduct. May they be worthy co-workers with our order, so that by their preaching and through the grace of the Holy Spirit, the words of the gospel may bear fruit in human hearts and reach even to the ends of the earth. Together with us, may they be faithful stewards of your mysteries, so that your people may be renewed in the waters of rebirth and nourished from your altar, so that sinners may be reconciled and the sick be raised up. May they be joined with us, Lord, in imploring your mercy for the people entrusted to their care and for all the world. And so may the full number of the nations gathered together in Christ be transformed into your one people and made perfect in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Jesus Christ, whom the Father anointed with the Holy Spirit and power. Guard and preserve you, that you may sanctify the Christian people and offer sacrifices to God. The Lord Jesus Christ, whom the Father anointed with the Holy Spirit and power, guard and preserve you that you may sanctify the Christian people and offer sacrifices to God.
Receive this oblation of the holy people to be offered to God. Understand what you do, imitate what you celebrate, and model your life to the mystery of the Lord's cross. Receive the oblation of the holy people to be offered to God. Understand what you do, imitate what you celebrate, and conform your life to the mystery of the Lord's cross.
Thank you.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable unto God, the Almighty Father. Consecrate, O Lord, the oblations which we offer unto thee, and with them accept on our behalf the prayers of thy blessed apostles, and thereby cleanse us from all sin, and defend us from all adversities, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Shepherd of thy flock, Jesus Christ our Lord, who after his resurrection sent forth his apostles to preach the gospel and to teach all nations, and promised to be with them always, even unto the end of the ages. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, most merciful Father, we humbly pray thee through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord. And we ask that thou accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices. We offer them unto thee first for thy holy Catholic Church, that thou vouchsafe to keep her in peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with thy servant Francis, our Pope, with me, thine unworthy servant, and all the faithful guardians of the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Remember, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids, especially Gregory and Robert. And all who here around us stand, whose faith is known unto thee and their steadfastness manifest, on whose behalf we offer unto thee, or who themselves offer unto thee this sacrifice of praise, for themselves and for all who are theirs, for the redemption of their souls, for the hope of their health and well-being, and to offer their prayers unto thee, the eternal God, the living and the true.
United in one communion, we venerate the memory first of the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, of blessed Joseph, her spouse, as also of thy blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Thaddeus, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John, and Paul, Cosmas, and Damian, and all thy saints. Grant that by their merits and prayers, we may in all things be defended with the help of thy protection.
This then is the oblation of our service and that of thine whole family, which we offer also for thy servants, whom thou hast kindly advanced to the order of the priesthood. We beg thee graciously to accept it, Lord, and in thy mercy to preserve in them the gifts that thou hast given, that what they have received from thy divine goodness they may fulfill by the aid of thy divine grace. Vouchsafe, O God, we beseech thee in all things to make this oblation blessed, approved, and accepted, a perfect and worthy offering, that it may become for us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who the day before he suffered took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes lifted up to heaven unto thee, God, his almighty Father, giving thanks to thee, he blessed, broke, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Likewise, after supper, taking also this goodly chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to thee, he blessed and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Thy servants and thy holy people also, remembering the blessed passion of the same Christ, thy Son, our Lord, as also his resurrection from the dead, and his glorious ascension into heaven, do offer unto thine excellent majesty of thine own gifts and bounty, the pure victim, the holy victim, the immaculate victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Vouchsafe to look upon them with a merciful and pleasant countenance, and to accept them, even as thou didst vouchsafe to accept the gifts of thy servant Abel the righteous, and the sacrifice of our patriarch Abraham, and the holy sacrifice, the immaculate victim, which thy high priest Melchizedek offered unto thee. We humbly beseech thee, Almighty God, command these offerings to be brought by the hands of thy holy angel to thine altar on high, in the sight of thy divine majesty, that all we who at this partaking of the altar shall receive the most sacred body and blood of thy Son may be fulfilled with all heavenly benediction and grace.
Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids who have gone before us sealed with the seal of faith and who sleep the sleep of peace. To them, O Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, we beseech thee to grant the abode of refreshing, of light, and of peace.
To us sinners also, thy servants, who hope in the multitude of thy mercies, vouchsafe to grant
some part in fellowship with thy holy apostles and martyrs, with John, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicitas, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and with all thy saints, within whose fellowship we beseech thee admit us, not weighing our merit, but granting us forgiveness.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom, O Lord, thou dost ever create all these good things, dost sanctify, quicken, bless, and bestow them upon us. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, to thee, O Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory throughout all ages, world without end. As our Savior Christ hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, O Lord, we beseech thee, from all evils, past, present, and to come, and at the intercession of the blessed and glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with thy blessed apostles Peter and Paul, and with Andrew and all the saints, favorably grant peace in our days, that by the help of thine availing mercy, we may ever both be free from sin and safe from all distress.
Christ, who saidst to thine apostles, Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of thy church, and grant to her peace and unity according to thy will, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us speak of peace. Alleluia.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same merciful whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, so that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him that taketh away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members and corporate in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. By the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son, and we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory. Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, who dost satisfy the hungry soul with bread from heaven, vouchsafe also to defend us, we beseech thee, by the prayers of thine apostles against all adversity. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. May God, who hath founded the church and doth guide her still, protect you constantly with his grace, that you may faithfully exercise the duties of the priesthood.
Amen.
May he make you servants and witnesses in the world to divine charity and truth, and faithful ministers of reconciliation. True shepherds to administer the living bread and word of life to the faithful, that they may grow evermore in the unity of the body of Christ.
Amen.
The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.